This talk is about, to an extent, about moose as well as moo, because I love moose. It is, believe it or not, moose started in 2006. It's been around a long time now. And about 0.18, Stephen Little came and spoke to me and said, "Hi, you've been using my Class C3 module in DBIX class a lot. I have this new idea I think you'll really like. It's called roles. Come and have a look at this." So I read the source code to Moose because, yes, there was documentation already, but I prefer reading Perl most of the time. And went, "Oh, wow!" And that was 2007 sometime. So, I mean, I think by now everybody who is here and doing Perl knows what Moose is. But I guess the question is, what is it to me? Why does it matter to me? And the answer is, the reason I've always loved writing OO code in Perl, even before Moose, is that I knew what it was capable of. I knew how powerful it could be. But getting at some of that power is quite difficult for some people. And Moose provides a much nicer way of doing that. So Moose shows just how powerful Perl's OO is in a way that is actually sensible to other people, which is the part that I could never figure out. Fortunately, Stephen Little did. So, great. Okay. We've used class accessor, then there's class make methods, class base. There were too many object builders. Every project, the first thing I'd have to do was go, what are they using to generate their accessors? And now I'm going to have to go and learn it. DBIX class had its own version, which ended up going on CPAN as well, because somebody wanted to use it in another project. Damien wrote class STD for Perl best practices, and it was awful, and nobody actually used that one. That was the failed attempt at standardizing. But Moose really is the one class builder to rule them all. And at the very least, the Moose syntax everybody expects now. Okay, I'm talking about Moo, so you can argue, did I stop using Moose? Well, no, I didn't really. Catalyst relies on Moose for a lot of the cleverness in 5.8 and 5.9. All of Shadowcat's customers have got Moose in their code bases somewhere, so I work with it most weeks, and that's great. Moose really is awesome. And actually, this entire thing is the Italians' fault, right? Because at the Italian Perl Workshop 2009, I gave a talk called Antiquated Perl, which was about old school tricks and ideas. And what I wrote, built up to at the end of that talk, was a micro framework called WebSimple. And so one of the things about WebSimple was I wanted it to be usable for CGI scripts. Basically, the purpose of WebSimple for my life was never have to use CGI.pm again. So that means you need fast startup, and if you're going to very easily get this code onto a server, you don't want to have excess dependencies. You want to be able to rsync it or FTP it or whatever. So at this point, I wrote my own accessors, I wrote my own constructor, and seriously, I felt like I had gone back to 1999. It was horrible, really. But I ended up with more projects that had the same sort of requirements. HTML Zoom, which is a sort of jQuery-ish templating system. Data Query, which still isn't on CPAN properly, but is, I've almost got DBIX class running on top of it, at which point I'll actually get around to putting it on CPAN. And Moose can stop people adopting it, because they go, "Oh, but I want to use this in a command line script. It needs to start in a quarter of a second." So, and you're now at this point of, that's great, but I want this OO, but I don't want to stop people using my code. Okay, so the first thing people always suggest is mouse. No. Okay, mouse can be pure Perl. Great. It describes itself as moose minus the antlers. That's a lie. It still has a meta model. There is still a meta class and meta attributes and all of those objects. So the antlers are still there, just smaller. Basically mouse is moose minus minus, which is fine. If that works for you, great. But I wanted a proper answer to the question, something that was designed from the ground up to solve this problem. So I spent about a year and a half hating myself, because in all of my spare time code, stuff not written for cPanel for customers, I didn't use an object system at all and wrote everything by hand. I do not recommend this as an experience. But I needed to know which parts of Moose I really missed. Method modifiers. You know, in Moose you can write before foo, call this other method. Nice and simple. How do you write that in pure Perl? You write it like that. Okay, it's only a bit uglier. How about after? Now, after has to preserve the return value. So instead of writing after, what you have to write is that. Check whether you're in list context or not, get the return value, do the call, and then do the return. That's horrible! And that's actually got a bug in it. It doesn't handle void context right. Oh my god, intelligent accessors. You know, in Moose, I can write that. It's read-only, here's a method to build the value, do it lazily. How do you write that by hand? You need to write that. Constructors that actually, you know, you declare a couple of attributes, and, you know, the values will go into the right slots, and it will check whether it's required. How do you write this by hand? You write that. If you're writing that, and that's only two attributes, you're writing that for every single class in your project, you are going to screw it up. You are going to have bugs all over the place. I don't want to be debugging this code like this all the time. Subclassing is, and runtime role application. You know, the ability to go, I have an object, add a role to it.
Nanos. On a une salle dédiée pour un clé en Perl, comme ça on a un tableau, on a un projecteur. Pour ceux qui sont intéressés, ça sera pour aujourd'hui, pour demain. Voilà, c'est tout. Mais pas de bol. Okay. 704,
donc. So, runtime role application. How do you, in Moose, you can say apply all roles. Just add these roles to the object. How do you do that in pure Perl? Well, the closest you get is that. Let's make a class name. Turn strict refs off, fiddle with that iser, do an eval to load things in, and then bless the... This is how ClassDBI did plugins. I wrote an entire ORM to not have to deal with ClassDBI. No. Horrible. I've been thinking about this and thinking about it and thinking about it. About 2 years ago, I was working at a customer's office in New York. It's kind of good fun. But I was bored one weekend. Yes, I was bored in New York. That's because I am bad at being a tourist. My idea of tourism is people, food, and beer. So during the day at the weekend, there was nothing I really wanted to do. So I went down to the hotel front desk and said, give me 12 of the... little sachets for the coffee machine, went across to Subway, bought two big sandwiches, and sat down and started writing code. I wrote the code. Reba, Sushi, and Fru, two of the DBIX class core team, wrote me tests. And at the end of the weekend, we actually had something that basically worked. And we've been improving it and tweaking it since. So, what does Moo actually give you? gives you access to generations, so you have your Haz declaration, RO lazy. I default in Moo have to be a subroutine reference. The reason for this being, people keep shooting themselves in the foot with non-subroutine defaults in Moose. Newbies basically might write the wrong thing and then get confused. In Moo, you're confused once when you realize it has to be a subroutine, but then it's always a subroutine, so you don't get confused again. And we added some simple sugar for common cases. Moose has a thing called lazy build. Lazy build was stolen from one of my code bases many years ago. Nobody actually stopped to ask, is this the right design? And the answer is, in its original code base, it was. For a Moose core feature, no, stupid idea. I wish they'd never stolen it, you know? the problem is, it doesn't just generate your builder, it sets up a predicate and declarer. Now, I was doing a user interface framework that had lots of dependent data that needed to be recalculated. So this was very useful for me. But most of the time, you don't want those. Too much API, you don't want extra public methods that aren't actually part of your project. So all you really need is that. So Moo provides is lazy. You just say that, it generates just those three. You can add the rest if you want. And if you're using Moose, I recommend looking at MooseX attribute shortcuts, because that provides the same syntax for Moose. And a bunch of other helpful things. Okay, so method modifiers. Method modifiers were easy. I loaded class method modifiers. It did it for me. Problem solved. So that gives you the before, after, and around stuff. Types. Okay. There is no type system in Moo. Number one, a type system is complicated. Number two, there's been lots of arguing about Moose's type system. There are things in it that are not perfect. So rather than copy stuff that we already knew we wanted to change, better to have nothing at all. But you still need to be able to do checks somehow. So what Moo does, pass a subroutine. Do whatever you like in the subroutine. Moo does not care. You just have to throw a sensible exception if it's not valid. That way, any type system can be plugged into Moo just by wrapping it in a subroutine. And since everybody kept writing their own tiny versions of the MooseX type syntax, there's still one in Dancer 2 that I need to help Sakria rip out sideways. Mattia wrote a thing called MooseX types Moose-like, which gives you MooseX types style types in Moo. And so you can import a stir constant and use that for your ism. Okay, great. There are a few other differences. Moose provides use strict and use warnings by default. That's another thing they stole out of my code without asking if it was right. Moo exports a thing called strictures, which is slightly different. What strictures does is it doesn't just turn warnings on, but it makes them fatal. Because any time my Perl code generates a warning, that indicates a mistake. Either I should have done something to make it not warn, or I have a bug. And I want my test suite to stop when that happens, so I can go and find out. Because the annoying thing about warnings is, you will often have a situation where you get the same warning repeated 5,000 times. And actually, there was a different warning before that one that actually tells you what the problem is. And going and finding that is... So, turn it on. Strictures also, if you run it from a test file, it disables indirect object syntax, so you can't get your method calls wrong. It disables accidental use of multi-dimensional hashes, because that's an old feature that we don't use anymore. and it kills bare word file handles so that you actually have to do open my.fh. So it catches a bunch of extra common errors. Because those three all require access, they're only turned on in tests. The idea being that if you're developing a project, you should be able to install lots of things, but for running it, you shouldn't need to install those extra checking things. And most importantly, I want to be as strict as possible by default, because the people who really need that are the people who are new, and the people who are new don't know how to change the defaults yet. So, you know, if you hate fatal warnings, fine, turn them off. But now, at least, there is a record in the code of you turning them off. And for anybody who just writes use moo, they get it as safe as possible. Okay. That's great, but what about cooperating with moos? Well, we win. If you have a moo class, and you require moos, you can call meta on your moo class and get a moose meta class back. We keep the information, and when you first try and use a moo class as a moose class, it sets everything up so it looks like your class was always moose. So basically, moo pretends. It sets everything up well enough, but moose does not notice the difference. Which means, unlike with mouse, you don't need an any moose. Moo is its own any moose already. Makes life so much simpler. So you can have a moo class and use a moose role in it. You can have a moose class and use a moo role in it. But we started to have fun in the tests. Are you familiar with the game Jenga? You stack bits of wood on top of each other and then try and not make it fall over? We played Jenga. We could go moo, and moo can take mouse, and then moose can take moo. So, for the first time, you can actually apply a mouse role to a moose class. You just have to put moo in between, because moo can talk to both of them. And mouse doesn't talk to anything except mouse, which is why I ended up writing moo. But yeah, Jenga. I had a test for moose subclassing a moo class, which is subclassing a moose class, which is subclassing a moo class. And then just because it was funny, I wrote another one that puts moo at the top and mouse on the bottom. And it still works! The other nice thing is, moo is pure Perl. No matter how you install moo, it's always pure Perl. Mouse checks to see if it has a compiler. So you can end up with a version that thinks it's XS, and then you ship it out to a server, and suddenly the XS part isn't... Oh, no. Pure Perl. But if you install things like class XS accessor, moo goes, aha! You installed the faster thing. I'll just use it for you, then. At some point, we need to steal the mouse accessor code, so I can do that for every sort of accessor. But it's not really that big a deal to me at the moment. But the crucial thing is, the only access things that Moo cares about are part of Perl. You do not need any compiled CPAN modules to run Moo, ever. Which means that you can use AppFatPacker. You can turn a script using Moo into a single file and just copy that single file to any machine and it will just run. You can deploy Moo applications using Moo via FTP. Which is important, apparently. Any time we introduce an XS module into DBIX classes dependency chain, we get upset people on the mailing list who are going, but I'm putting DBIX class as a CGI script via FTP. The funny thing is, they all come from one country. Apparently Germany has not yet discovered shared hosting with shell access. I don't understand. Anyway. And being able to do all this, let me write something called Object Remote, which is going to go to CPAN in about the next week. An Object Remote, you can actually load a class call new colon and give it the name of the server. Object remote SSHs into that other server, sends itself over the SSH connection, and starts up a copy of your object on the other machine that you can now call methods on. And the reason it can do that is because Moo can be sent over the wire to the other server, because it's pure Perl. So, basically, it works. It gives me all of the parts of Moose that I really miss when I'm in a situation where, for whatever reason, I don't want to use Moose. So I do invite you to try it out. If the wireless network had actually existed here, the next slide would have been me uploading 1.0 to CPAN. But it doesn't, so it isn't. But I'll do that when I get back. The 0.991 whatever up there already works perfectly. It's in production all sorts of places now. I mean, the ShadowCat website is a web simple application that uses a lot of Moo, so... And basically, if you find yourself asking the question, I'm not sure if I should use Moose for a particular project, use Moo. More importantly, use Moo first, because the entire design of Moo is that Moose will always still be there later. So anytime you get to the point where you really need something that's in Moose but not in Moo, just start using Moose for that part. That's great. Moose is wonderful. I'm not trying to stop people using it. I'm trying to make it easier to not use Moose yet. Yeah? For user questions, we're now quite happily answering on #moose. Most of the Moo developers are on #websimple, so that's where we have most of the conversations about patching it, so we don't disrupt the Moose development channel. And to explain the original joke, Moo, ASCII-wise, is 60% of Moose. So I have always said Moo is almost but not quite two-thirds of Moose. Thank you very much. Any questions? Yeah, it always scares me when there are no questions. I'm going, does that mean I explained everything? Or does that mean nobody understood anything I just said?
Do you have something to say about the even more minimal frameworks like Mo and M and half an M?
I uploaded M. M does absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
Although, the second release of M I actually made a second release whose entire purpose was to test that search.cpan and meta.cpan would handle mail-to bug tracker links properly. So that we could point out to Mark Lehman that if he actually set his modules up properly, people wouldn't keep posting to rt.cpan. Of course, being Mark Lehman, he completely ignored this and is continuing to be an idiot, but, you know, bloody Germans again. Mo was written because Inge wanted something that he could inline into a project. The point of Mo is you generate 200 characters of completely unreadable crack and then paste that into a file. And you have a miniature object system there, which is, I can see the use of it. At some point, I would like to write a Moo colon colon compile so that when you use Moo, it generates out all of the work so you can have a distribution that uses it, but you don't actually need to install Moo to use it. And at that point, I will start arguing that Moo is obsolete and can go away. But until that point, Mo, if you don't want to have any dependencies at all and would rather copy and paste a tiny object system into your project, yes, Mo is very useful. I do not want to use that. It scares people. It scares me! I'm not afraid of Audrey Tang's code. Mo is Inge got upset that Moo was more than five files, basically. And it's Inge, and it works. And I did actually help him golf Mo, because that was funny. Because it made it even smaller and even more impossible to read. Which, for the one purpose of pasting it in, is a really good thing. But, really, no. You are not Ingi. Do not use this.
With the remote object, does that imply that FATPACK needs to be installed on the receiving system or not?
Well, no, because if FATPACK needed to be installed on the other side, it would be completely useless.
Right.
FATPACKer is basically the 20% of the logic of PAR that works for pure Perl. And object remote does a bunch of other clever bits, but you can. The video for my lightning talk from the CNA about that is on the web, so. But yeah, the idea with object remote is basically it FATPACKs itself and then sends the FATPACK version across. Whereas, I mean, if you want to see the output from that FATPACKer, look at CPAN minus. That's how CPAN minus is made into a single file using FATPACK. So that shows you what it looks like. FATPACKer was part of my continued quest to say to people, yes, you can use CPAN. Oh, but I can't install modules on that system. You can install your script. I can install my script, but I can't install much. FATPACKer, modules in script. One script, code, and modules. Copy script, use CPAN. I do understand the I don't want that many dependencies, but really, not using CPAN is just being dependent on yourself, and you on your own are going to end up with more bugs than a CPAN module that's been around for years. Excellent. I'm going to fall over sideways now because it's too hot. Thank you very much. I am from Northwest.